Good evening, and welcome to the February 28th, 2018, meeting of the Public Works Committee of the Abington Township Board of Commissioners. And may I have a roll call, please? Here.
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 Thank you. Please note that Commissioner Brodsky is excused this evening. Our first order of business this evening is to approve the minutes of the January 31st, 2018 Public Works Committee meeting, and may I have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Are there any additions or corrections to the minutes from members of the committee? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. The Public Works Committee has four items of business this evening. The first is PW1, and this is a two-part motion. And the first is to consider a motion to award Glasgow Incorporated bid as lowest responsible bid of Part 1 and Part 2 of the Superpave bid, and enter into contract with Glasgow Incorporated in the amount of $1,049,120 for the purchase and delivery of Superpave paving materials as per bid specifications. And the second component is to consider a motion to award Eureka Stone Quarry Incorporated bid as lowest responsible bid of Part 3 of the Superpave bid, and enter into a contract with Eureka Stone Quarry Incorporated in the amount of $42,125 for the purchase and delivery of Superpave paving materials as per bid specifications, and I so move.
Second.
Are there questions or comments from members of the committee? Fellow commissioners. Commissioner Klein.
Thank you. There was a bid tabulation sheet. I don't see that. And
I thought it was in there.
How did these numbers come in compared to our budgeted numbers for 2018?
They came in, well, Glasgow was a low bidder for the 20,000 tons of wearing material for the overlay, the majority of that, and that was at $51.10. The next highest bidder was Eureka, which was $51.25. So Glasgow got that. They came in with what we anticipated. And then the other part of the bid, which was for the base and binder material, which we don't use that much of, that came in at, with Eureka Stone Quarry being a low bidder on that part at $42.75, where Glasgow was $47 a ton.
So overall, you think the numbers
are good.
The tabulation came in less than our budget?
Yes.
Thank you.
Any other comments or questions from commissioners? Any comments from members of the audience? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
PW2 is a motion to consider to award Commonwealth Precast Incorporated their bid as lowest responsible bid and enter into a contract with Commonwealth Precast Incorporated in the amount of $67,160 for the purchase and delivery of storm sewer inlets and manhole structures as per bid specifications, and I so move.
Second.
Any comments or questions from members of the committee? Fellow commissioners. Commissioner Klein.
Yeah, I mean, just in the future, can we put on here, because I ask this question all the time, just where this came in as far as our budget was concerned. So if we can start to, I know we have it up in the corner, the budget implications, but it doesn't specifically talk about how it relates to the actual budgeted numbers in the fiscal budget.
So you just like a note that says whether it's at, under, or over budget?
Yeah, when we put all this other information in there, I'd like to know where we stand with the budget on,
sure,
these, on these larger items and these bid items that we have every year.
We can include that in the summary.
Thank you. So was this under budget, at budget, above budget?
This was under budget. This came in good.
Okay, thank you.
Any other comments or questions from commissioners? Any comments from the audience? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. PW3 is a motion to consider to award Delaware Valley Concrete Company, Incorporated, their bid as lowest responsible bid and enter into a contract with Delaware Valley Concrete Company Incorporated in the amount of $6,752 for the purchase and delivery of ready-mix concrete as per bid specifications, and I so move.
Second.
Are there comments or questions from members of the committee? I don't think we need to call on Commissioner Klein again. We'll just assume that that question will be asked.
This came in within budget, and they were considerably lower than the next bidder.
I see that.
All right. Yep. Might as well wait for the next one.
Sounds good, Angelo. Thank you. Are there any comments from members of the audience? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. And finally, PW4, which is a motion to consider to award the 2018 milling project bid. And I think I'll turn this over to Angelo.
Okay, this was a good bid. We sent out for 6 bids. We got 8 back. And we had a very unusual thing that never happened to us before. We had a tie, and both contractors came in lower than we anticipated. So the bottom line is, we checked with council, and we did a coin toss, and James D. Marcy won the coin toss, and he's the low bidder.
Interesting. What coin did you use?
Mr. Manfredi's coin.
Thank
it worked
you.
That good, and we're very comfortable with them, so.
Mm-hmm. We've used them before.
Yeah. Okay. We don't anticipate no problems.
Do any commissioners have any comments or questions for Angelo?
Anything else?
Answer my question, so I'm good.
I'm done?
I can't promise that, but at least for
got
now.
You,
I'm going to call you. Yeah. Comments from members of the audience?
Laura Lehman, 1431 Bryant Lane. So I just wanted to understand where this is milling the road. I understand you can mill the road and then you can return that into paving again. Is that what they're doing? They're reconstituting it to paving that we use?
Well, I think this is for a couple of purposes. We could ask the manager or Angelo to answer that question directly.
She needs to sit down first.
But if you could just kindly take your seat or at least sit there while the question's being answered.
To answer that question, the quarries use a percentage of the recycled material in the making asphalt. It's not 100%, but I think it's like 20% of it okay. They use.
20% of what they
mill, are we getting
the same thing?
No, Angela.
Come on.
I don't think she's asking what the product that is milled is used for. I think she's asking about the project itself. At once we mill, explain to her that you just mill the road and then you do overlay separately.
Yeah, the contractor mills the road. He takes the material back to the asphalt plant. They use a percentage of that to make new material and bring us new material to lay down. And we do the actual paving.
Okay.
So that comes from what you mill?
Yes.
Thank you.
Are there any other comments from members of the audience about PW4? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. At this point in the meeting, we will now entertain comments from members of the audience related to general matters of public works.
Laura Lehman, 1431 Bryant Lane. So we did just get a new engineer, and I don't know if I missed a whole step there or what, but it seemed like we agreed that we were going to advertise just to see what outside engineers cost, and then we came back and we said okay, we decided to go with our in-house engineer. Then our in-house engineer went half-time. Not sure how that happened because he had a full-time job. I don't know how the engineering all of a sudden just got cut in half because he wanted to go half-time, but that seems to have happened. And now, all of a sudden, we appointed a new engineer. Did I miss a discussion on, a public discussion on that we were going to accept it, what the bids were, what the difference in cost were? Did I miss a public discussion that we had?
No, this is a personnel matter, and so the Director of Engineering reports directly to the Township Manager, and he is given the authority by the Board of Commissioners to make those hirings with our consent, and we consented to that hire.
Yeah, well, when did you consent? That's my concern. When did you consent? That's supposed to be public information. You're not supposed to consent.
It was made public at the appointment of the Township Engineer at the previous meeting.
So it wasn't made public before, because there wasn't any, that was at a Board of Commissioners meeting without any committee meeting before it to discuss that, right?
So this has been discussed repeatedly over the last several months between the Township Manager and the Board in executive session to discuss Township personnel.
Okay, so what you just told me, if I understand, I may be missing something, is that the manager made the decision to go with the engineer and you approved it, but at
we consented to his decision, yes, which is what we do in these matters.
Yes, but normally that's sent first to committee meeting, right?
The personnel are the direct purview of the entire board, and personnel matters are handled in executive session.
All right. Well, kindly then, can you explain that if something like that comes up again, explain for the public. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Are there other comments from members of the audience related to general matters of public works? If not, I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. Let's call to order the Administrative Code and Land Use Committee for February 28, 2018. And may I have a roll call, please?
Commissioner Sanchez?
Here.
Gillespie?
Here.
Becker?
Here.
Thompson?
Here.
And let's note for the record that Commissioner Brodsky is excused for the evening. First, we will consider approval of the minutes, and I'll make a motion to approve the minutes of the January 31st, 2018 Administrative Code and Land Use Committee meeting. I so move.
Second.
I moved and seconded. Any comments or corrections to the minutes? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. The minutes are approved. As we have no presentations or unfinished business, we can move right into new business. And the first item on our agenda tonight is to consider approving the land development application submitted by ABH Builders Incorporated for the vacant property located at 1043 Easton Road, Abington, PA 19001. And Mr. Penicow is going to be presenting, or
yes,
no applicant.
Good evening, Commissioners. The applicant is here. This was heard last night by the Planning Commission. It's a simple land development. You have a four-unit apartment complex being built in Commissioner Spiegelman's ward. Take access from the site from Easton Road. There were some items within the staff review letter that needed to be addressed. The applicant has committed to make the plan conform as far as the two zoning hearing board related issues, one being the size of the parking stalls, two being the buffer that wasn't provided. The Planning Commission had extensive comments that they provided to you. I believe a copy was forwarded to you today. There are some conditions and some waivers that were laid out for you in that staff review memo. The applicant was in agreement last night. He is here if anyone would like to see a short presentation. I know he has a rendering of the building to show you if the need arises.
Two things. I don't think I saw the Planning Commission letter.
No, we have.
We did not get
it. That just happened.
Or is you
talking? We don't have a staff review either.
Mr. Penicow, explain to them. Go ahead. Explain to them why they don't have a staff review. They're asking about the staff review.
There was a staff review letter that was generated. Should have been included in your packet. The staff review letter, there were two zoning related issues that were originally on the plan. The applicant had submitted a plan with parking stall sizes that were 9x18s instead of the required 10x18s. And the side yards did not have the required buffer areas. There was ample green space along both side property lines, but no plantings were shown there. The balance of the staff review letter dealt with a stormwater management plan that conformed. It dealt with some comments about trash removal. The applicants committed to use our Public Works Department rather than a private hauler for that. The staff review letter was the standard building permit, plumbing permit related items. In addition to that, Montgomery County Planning Commission reviewed the plan. I hope you did receive a copy of that.
That we have.
Mr. Narkowitz was at our meeting last night to discuss it and had some conditions. The Planning Commission met last night. They recommended approval of the plan. They had some conditions that they had laid out where they recommended the board take under consideration. The first being the consideration that the staff review comments of the February 7, 2018 letter be taken under advisement by the board and be addressed to your satisfaction. The applicant has submitted a DEP planning module to Mr. Wrigley, and that is currently under review. The applicant, the county would like a crosswalk installed at the base of the driveway to connect the newly installed sidewalk that'll run the 100 linear feet that this property has frontage. There's a notation on here, the plan does not include any parking lot lighting. Parking lot lighting will have to be installed and will have to comply to code. The two street trees, because of the elevational change between Easton Road and the front of this property, will have public sidewalk installed. There'll be a retaining wall, and then there's roughly 8 feet before you end up with the front facade of the building. Our personal feeling between the county and myself was that wasn't ample room to plant street trees. So we're going to move those, if it's the desire of the board, move those to those side yard areas that have 12 and 20 foot widths and plant the trees there and give them the opportunity to grow. There was a small portion of the neighbor's driveway that's shown on the plan that exceeds over the property line. We just need that mark to be removed. The applicant's committed to do that. There's a portion of the parking lot that's a hashed area that's over and above what's needed for handicap accessibility. It was the recommendation of the Planning Commission that that area be returned to green space instead of left as paved surface. The Planning Commission recommended that a sidewalk be installed behind the building to connect the parking lot out to the public sidewalk, and also that walkway be large enough to allow those residents access with their trash cans out to Easton Road. The stormwater management plan will have to be revised slightly with widening the parking spaces to 10 feet. You're looking at an additional 198 square feet worth of impervious coverage. The plan will still remain compliant for impervious coverage, building space, building coverage, and green space. The applicant's permitted up to 90% impervious coverage. This plan is just under 54%. We asked that the Planning Commission recommend that since there was lengthy discussion on trash removal, private versus public, the applicant wanted to use the public system we have in place, that they contact our refuge department to make arrangements for that. Of course, the plan must be revised to show the two zoning issues with the parking stall size and the buffers, and we have the existing pavers. There was a list of waivers the applicant was requesting, one of which the Planning Commission did not approve, and they hope the board will not approve it as well. The Planning Commission, as with staff, would like a landscape plan. This is a vacant lot that has some wooded growth on it, just so we can confirm that it conforms to the requirements of the ordinance for tree removal and tree replacement. We would ask that a landscape plan be submitted so we can make sure things comply. The applicant committed last evening, and he is here, you can hear from him if you so desire, that whatever the board would make recommendation of tonight, he would then have his engineer, Mr. Rose, revise the plan prior to the Board of Commissioners meeting in March. So I can answer whatever other questions you have. If not, the applicant is here for you as well.
Let me just ask one question, Mr. Panikel, before I open it up to everyone. This still has to go to the zoning board, is that?
No, it does not, sir. The applicant's elected to revise the plans to comply with the zoning code.
Okay, gotcha. I thought I heard that, and wasn't sure.
Commissioner Gillespie's on the committee, so.
Thank you. Mark, I was just wondering, you said a crosswalk at the bottom of their driveway across Eastern Road?
No, not across Eastern Road, Commissioner.
That's what I was trying to, I'm like, well, that would be crazy. That's in the middle of the hill, you know?
It'll still be within the public right-of-way. It's just a hashed area that'll clearly delineate the connection between the two public sidewalks.
You mean the driveway and the two sidewalks? I'm like.
So the sidewalk will literally, or the crosswalk will run north to south on Eastern Road in line with the sidewalk that's being installed. County thought that was important with the location of the train station a block away.
Commissioner Hecker.
Thank you. So I thought the recommendations from the County Planning Commission were actually quite good. And so in listening to your list, am I to understand that the applicant has agreed to what the County Planning Commission has recommended?
Correct.
Can I ask one question?
Commissioner Spiegel.
Commissioner Klein.
Why isn't the applicant speaking and making these kind of?
The applicant's here if you'd like to hear from him.
I mean, that's who we're asking to make these concessions, is the applicant. So we shouldn't have the.
Sir?
And I think that's especially important if the applicant is agreeing to things.
Yeah.
It's important that we hear from the applicant agreeing to them and not from Mr. Penicow saying that the applicant has agreed to it.
Should I re-ask my question?
Yeah, I think if we want to know if they're agreeing to anything, we should ask the applicant directly.
Okay. Hi there. My name is Arthur Hurling with ABH Builders. I came last night, had a nice conversation with the Planning Commission. Along with Montgomery County Planning Commission, they gave me a bunch of ideas, and seems we're on the same page, and we're going to make some modifications to the plans and resubmit in the next couple weeks.
So there's nothing, I didn't mean to jump in, there's nothing in the what the County Planning Commission
recommended. I don't have it in front of me, but I think based on everything we talked about yesterday, it's pretty straightforward.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I do have a rendering here just yes. to give you an idea of what we anticipate the project.
Townhome, so. Nice looking. It looks very nice.
So the rendering doesn't show the sidewalk. Can you just point out where the sidewalk's going to go?
So this is Eastern Road. We're going to put a sidewalk here. This is I'm sorry. The cross
edge. Oh, yeah. You got to go back on mic.
Maybe somebody called it. Sorry about that.
No problem. Yeah, so this is Eastern Road. Mm-hmm. The sidewalk's going to be put in here. And this is the cross hatch Mr. Penicow was talking about. That'll be.
So the crosswalk goes across the driveway?
Right. Correct. So okay. It's sidewalk will stop, you have the crosswalk, and then the sidewalk continues.
So I see some grading issues on there. I mean, there's you got a retaining wall now on the, I go with the southwest side. And then the plan that I'm looking at in front of me has topography that kind of goes around the corner on the northeast side. It looks like it has a pretty steep cross slope on the sidewalk.
Yeah, so that's ADA on the review letter, the staff letter, they recommended that we push that back to allow room for the sidewalk. So what you see in the plan there is going to be modified.
Okay.
So the wall will stop right before the sidewalk, so it won't interfere with anyone walking back and forth.
Perfect.
Commissioner Spiegelman.
Thank you, Commissioner Sanchez. I can tell you there hasn't been any feedback at all. This has been put out to not only all the neighbors, but really everybody in the ward, and there hasn't been any feedback. I don't think anyone has a problem with this. I happen to know the owners of the now empty and sort of, you know, pretty meaningless lot are also Ward 11 folks, very nice folks. So this is a beautiful rendering. So first I got to see this because I wasn't able to make it to the Planning Commission meeting last night. Just wanted to reiterate, very much in support of following those recommendations of the Montgomery County Planning Commission. And also, I just want to make sure that by the time this comes to the whole board, if we can see the staff review letter and the Township Planning Commission's letter and just everything, you know, all the missing pieces are here, that would be great to be able to vote on this. But looks great. I mean, I look forward to being neighbors with that nice building.
Thank you, Commissioner Spiegelman. Other comment, Commissioner Klein.
Yeah, I actually would suggest that the committee pass this along without recommendation until we have the staff review letters in hand and the Planning Commission's review letters, and even a better plan. I mean, it's hard to read. You know, I don't understand all of the things, and I would like to see how the staff review letters relate to the drawings. I think it's an incomplete submission to the board to do anything with at this point. So I would recommend, my recommendation would be to have the committee pass it along without recommendation, and that the board gets all the information prior to doing anything with it. I don't understand why we don't have everything in front of us.
I tend to agree with you there, sir, on that. Just like to have it compiled. Not that it's a bad thing if we pass it along without recommendation. It does move forward to the next step, but then we can see it.
I did have one other question. Yeah. The parking spaces, are what size are they on the plan?
They're 10 foot wide. Well, on your plan, they're probably not. We're revising them to 10 foot wide.
But I thought our zoning ordinance allowed for 9 by 18.
For single family residential, I thought that was.
Commissioner Klein, that never made it into the final edit. They're listed as 10 by 18.
Okay.
Commissioner Spiegelman.
Thank you again, Commissioner Sanchez. I concur with Commissioner Klein's recommendation. And just one thing, I would, obviously, again, we're going to get a whole set of revised plans before next Thursday, before Thursday the 1st. Definitely want to see exactly where the sidewalks are going to be running. But I mean, that's going to be part of the new plan. So thank you.
Any other commissioners? So with that, I would make a motion
I would say one other thing. I would make a suggestion that the applicant be here on Thursday's meeting to respond to any questions or any conditions that may come up at the board meeting, and that should be done by the developer or the applicant.
Is that okay with
you? Is
that
next Thursday?
That's next Thursday.
Okay. I don't know if we'll have a resubmission by then, but be happy to be here and go over any plans we have, yeah.
So with that, I would make a motion that we pass this along, but without recommendation, and then we will get the compiled version with the incorporating the Planning Commission recommendations, both Planning Commissions, that is the Township and the County Planning Commission, and any resubmissions by the applicant. And I so move.
Seconded.
Moved and seconded. Yes, we do. And we'll take public comment on this matter. If you could step aside for a moment. Thank you. Your name for the record and 3 minutes, please.
Laura Lehman, 1431 Bryant Lane, and it's really refreshing to see somebody come in and build to code and actually cooperate in so many ways. So that's wonderfully refreshing. I would love to see you all hold the line and ask other people to do the same thing. I just wanted to comment that I'm not sure why in our zoning code that we just made, we made 90% coverage of the property when, you know, that obviously leaves other people responsible for the absorptive and other qualities. Also, I just heard tonight somebody recommending the 9-foot parking spaces. I have a vehicle I can't get in a 9-foot. I drive round and round Trader Joe's looking for a larger spot. And you have heard that again and again. So to take somebody who said they have 10-foot spots and actually try to encourage them to make 9-foot spots is beyond me. 9-foot spaces are not in our interest. I know they went into the new code. They shouldn't be there. People get dings in their doors and you don't pay for them. That's a tax on them. So I just wanted to say that the other thing on this property that would have been a bonus, and you talked about, you know, some of the side yard issues, is that they get a bonus in our zoning for looking for shared parking and having less of a side yard. More of a side yard is what we need, and more green space and wider parking spaces for the convenience of the people. Until we all drive compact cars, then maybe 9 will be okay. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. All right. Any other comments from the public on this item? Hearing none. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion carries. Next, we will consider a motion to establish a policy where township permit or fees of any kind are not waived. Consider a motion to establish a policy where township permit or fees of any kind are not waived except for political subdivisions of the Commonwealth to be effective 6 months from enactment of the resolution setting forth this policy. And I so move.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any comments from commissioners?
Yeah, the question.
Mr. Hecker.
So for the manager and the solicitor, can we define for the committee and the board what we mean by political subdivisions of the Commonwealth?
It's actually defined in the law. What is a political subdivision? School districts. So it's defined in the law, so it's incorporated by reference. But we can get you that. I can get you that for the next meeting, specifically what the law says, what the code says.
Commissioner Bowman.
So just to be clear then, henceforth, if we adopt this, only the school board would be entitled to waiver.
Now, any political subdivision of the Commonwealth, meaning school districts, and I don't have it in front of me, I apologize.
The state of Pennsylvania, obviously.
In the Commonwealth, that's correct.
That's right. Okay.
Is that any idea? Universities like Penn State?
Well, Penn State is actually, I believe, and the solicitor can correct me if I'm wrong, but they're exempted under the law.
And they're not considered a political subdivision in the Commonwealth, kind of their own universe. But yeah.
Yes. And the idea was very simply to simply end the practice of waiving fees. And the idea of recommending a 6-month period is so that you can give notice to those who may want to. So there's a period of time where, you know, if they come in, they're going to come to you. So there's a 6-month period. If there's a request for a waiver, it will come to you.
Other comments? Commissioner Myers.
Thank you. In this 6-month interim, would we be taking requests on a case-by-case basis?
Yes.
Okay. And the solicitor said that Penn State is in a category of its own. Is there anything else in a category of its own?
Penn State is not a political subdivision. They don't qualify, right, what Richard's referring to. School districts, water and sewer authorities, boroughs, other entities that are created by the legislature, created by statute, are considered political subdivisions. No one else outside of that category would fall in, would be eligible for these waivers. So, and my comment about Penn State being in a category of their own was a bad attempt at humor, because most of the things that the legislature does, they seem to exempt Penn State from a lot of different things with regards to Penn State because of who they are. So
my point being that there's no other nonprofit entity that fits into a category.
There is not.
Okay.
Thank you, Commissioner Myers. Any other commissioners? Commissioner Zappone.
So let me get this straight. So we're exempting the school district, am I right?
Yeah, political subdivisions include the county, the township, the school district. If there's some duly incorporated sanitation or other utility authority, they would be exempted, and that's it.
So they automatically were waiving permit fees, and they can come before us wanting $300,000 of permit fees waived. We're just going to say, yeah, okay. Is that what this means, or am I reading it wrong?
Yes, that's what it means.
Really?
Yes.
So they're going to come before us, and we're going to just say, okay, we're absolving you of $300,000 of taxpayers' money. We're waiving it. Is that what this means?
The idea is that if it's a political subdivision of the Commonwealth, the taxpayers, for example, the school district, they're already, the taxpayers either paying, going to pay, if they have to pay us the fee, that's coming from the same taxpayer that's paying the fee. So that's why I'm recommending political subdivisions, because it's coming from one pocket of the taxpayer to the other pocket of the taxpayer. So if the school district, if the school district is made to pay those fees, it's coming from that same taxpayer that we're receiving the money from. It's coming from one pocket to the other.
No, it's not.
Something's not right about this at all. Okay, so I don't think we should be in a position of waiving permit fees. If I have to have something done at my house, I got to pay a permit. I'm a commissioner, I'm a state rep, I'm whatever. I don't think that's right.
Mr.
Should be waiving permit fees.
And that clearly is the purview of the governing body. It is just a recommendation. If the majority of commissioners feel that we should not waive any fees for anyone, then that's what you should do.
if one of us apply for a permit to put a whatever, we have to pay. We're commissioners. We have to pay. I'm going to pay. I have to pay. That's one thing I have to do. I have something built at my house. If I have an addition put on, I got to pay the fees. So to waive these, that to me, that's just like unheard of. I don't agree with this at all.
Well, then the motion could be to not do this. The motion could be to establish a policy that what does not waive fees for anyone.
I'll repeat again, and I've repeated this for years sitting up here about fees, permit fees and all. Okay, the little old lady next door to me, okay, she put something up, a 6-foot piece of fence. She has to pay a permit fee. Well, what am I going to pay that fee, or I have to get my medication to live? So what am I going to do? They sure as hell wouldn't waive any fees for this poor old lady next door. No, this is not right. And I'll speak out for years to come on this. It's not right.
Commissioner Bowman.
I would just say that it's a little different, though, when, as the manager says, Abington taxpayers ultimately would pay those fees. So I agree with the motion as it's written. And now that it's reduced to governmental entities, it seems to fit. Now we don't have to worry about the Boys Club or the GYAC or somebody else. They can't get waivers. All private entities cannot get a waiver. The only ones that are going to get a waiver are, like we said, maybe the water district or, you know, obviously the school board. So I agree with the motion.
Commissioner Klein.
So just to clarify, if the board was to choose to go in this direction, we're only talking about actual permit fees. If there are any kind of professional fees, you know, let's say traffic study reviews, engineer reviews, legal fees that have to be paid as part of a professional services agreement with with one of these governmental entities, those costs would still be reimbursed to the township. We're not talking about waiving those, just the permit fees.
Correct. It's professional service costs are not a fee.
Right.
Under this.
Okay.
Thank you. How often are we asked to waive fees? I mean, I've been here 8 years, whatever. We're not often asked, are we? Except recently, I know with what's going on with the school.
Right. You know, we had a few recently. The one outstanding was the VFW, still outstanding. So the VFW, it'd be up to you to decide if you wanted to consider waiving their fees, as you discussed it months ago. Mm-hmm. Since they're in the grace period, it would be completely up to the Board of Commissioners.
Mm-hmm. But after that?
After October 1, anyone who requests a waiver of fees, if they're not a political subdivision, if they're not a county, the school, they'll be told no.
Mm-hmm. That's tough. Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Thompson.
Have we considered the human cost for reviewing these permit applications? Are we able to collect money that would at least reimburse us for time spent by employees doing
well? That was part of the question. If there's any professional services, whether it's the solicitor's time or an engineer's review time, that's not.
But even like Mr. Panicale's time or anybody on staff?
That would not be charged. That is correct.
Commissioner Spiegelman.
This is a question, I think, for Manager Manfredi. I don't know if you would know this off the top of your head, but do other comparable municipalities or any other municipalities, say in the Montgomery County, have they enacted policies like this that you know of? Again, and it's...
I think most places deal with on a case-by-case basis. I think it's also important to note that, and we had this discussion publicly way back when, before we put this off to this date, we do not pay any fees to the Abington School District for anything we need. So whether their staff time is needed for if we're having an event there and their janitorial time or custodial time or staff time, they waive all fees for us. So this is really reciprocal.
Thank you, Mr. Manfredi.
Commissioner Gillespie.
Thank you. Thanks. But by doing this, then are we saying that, like, if the VFW after October can't, or somebody cannot ever come up, and we're saying never, right?
That is correct. You could always say that you could, you can create a classification. This is the discussion we had before. Where do you draw the line? Mm-hmm. And, you know, what not-for-profit do you draw the line? And the discussion was, should we waive any fees? Candidly, this is completely up to you. I'm only recommending this. It's your call. If you want to continue to do them on a case-by-case basis, you can. It's really your call.
Commissioner Hacker. So just a quick question in thinking this through. Does this represent a change from past practice with respect to the relationship with the school district? And I'm not sure that anybody here can necessarily answer that. But when they rebuilt the elementary schools and when the high school built Schwartzman Stadium, I mean, what was the position of the township with respect to those projects?
They asked us to waive fees, and we took a vote on it back then.
And do you remember what was the outcome? Did it?
Well,
I believe the fees were waived. I believe the fees were waived.
Majority of them went with giving the school district again whatever they want.
Okay.
Okay. That's the way it went some years ago.
Thank you.
Any other commissioners? Members of the audience.
Wow, every one of you received from me an email, the same email I sent out to residents in this township, about what an absolute sham this is. This is a way for residents to pay three times those fees, and I laid that out because, first of all, I don't have a number on the fees. Mr. Manfredi, did you bring a number for me, an approximate number based on?
It's public comment.
I did ask all of you, so perhaps you have a number, because none of you should be here without a number that's coming out of our budget. Nobody should be approving anything without knowing how much money that is in our budget, because at budget time you tell us, oh, we're so tight we can't do anything more. Okay, so what is the number? Do we have a number?
2 minutes remaining.
I'm sorry?
2 minutes remaining.
Can you please not use up my time doing that instead of answering? Could you tell me, do you know the number, Mr.
No.
Sanchez?
No, we don't know the number.
Do you know the number, Mr. Sanchez? Because you shouldn't be voting on this without knowing the number.
5 seconds remaining.
You're not going to answer, right?
That's correct. That's pretty
clear. I can't even imagine anything more ignorant. Okay. This is so unbelievable that this is what we call our government. This is such a simple question. What is the number of the school district? If Mr. Manfredi knows, will you let him answer? Are you going to prevent him from answering? The way that taxpayers will pay three times is, first, they will pay for the loan that the school district gets, which will surely include the cost of the permit fees. And that will be, over a long haul, they'll be paying for that money. Then, when they come to the township and have all their fees waived, they'll be paying for Mr. Penical's time and everybody else's time and all the money and all the documents and everything else. So then they're paying twice. And then, as we saw at a recent meeting, somebody said, well, and Mr. Manfredi just said now, well, they do a quid pro quo and we get free space at the school. So now, what should be reimbursed to the school and properly charted in their notes is not being charted. Third time, the taxpayer pays. He pays to the nonprofit that may be told he can use those facilities. We have who knows how much. The other thing that was awful is that this was brought up in a way that was so sneaky. It was brought up with $10,000 that was actually just the escrow. I think it was $11,000 total, instead of the actual number of what was to be waived. And they requested that the fees be waived. That $90 million is a whole lot more than $10,000. So all of this is absolutely wrong, and both of the accounting sides are completely messed up when you do it this way.
Thank
it is
not comments.
A wash. That project should have proper accounting, and our budget should have proper accounting.
Thank you for your comments.
Yeah.
Commissioner Bowman.
Yeah, just to clear that up, if the speaker would recall, Mr. Penicale told us when the school board was here that the number is not known yet because the school board is revising their construction situation. So we don't have the fee number yet. And this motion is a theory. It's a theory motion saying, do you agree in theory that the school board is the only person that should get a waiver of their fees? Some of us agree with that. It's not asking for a specific amount, ma'am. It's a theoretical issue.
Bring it in here a little bit. Any other comments from commissioners? All right. So it's been moved and seconded. All those in favor of the motion, say aye. Aye.
I'm struggling too.
Any opposed?
Opposed.
I'm opposed.
Opposed.
Right now, I'm just not ready.
Motion does not carry.
Thank you.
All right. Moving on to item number three. This is to consider a motion to adopt Resolution 1816 of the Township of Abington, authorizing the approval of Letter Amendment E to the reimbursement agreement with the Pennsylvania Department of Transportation to amend the final design costs in accordance with Supplement E to the engineering agreement with the project engineer, Pannoni Associates Incorporated, for the road construction project located along or near State Route 2034, Edge Hill Road, Section MGIR/W, and or State Road 2036, Tyson Avenue, Section MGIR/W, Federal Project Number X-064193-L240, Pennsylvania Department of Transportation Project MPMS-57865, and I so move.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Mr. Manfredi, could you give us a little explanation, or is this Solicitor Clark?
This is essentially amending the agreement between the Department of Transportation, the Township, and Pannoni Associates on the Edge Hill Tyson project. Because of a variety of reasons, Pannoni has had to revise some of the plans over time as they're getting ready to get this to go out for bid. They've also had to revise the plans frequently over the last year plus for the right-of-way acquisition. As of right now, we've acquired the right-of-way for 205 of the 209 properties. There are only four properties left. The four properties that remain are not people who are not willing to sign. It's people who don't have all of their documentation yet. These are some of the larger properties. And because of some of the redesign, that's been involved with the stormwater, Pannoni has needed to redo the plans several times. And what PennDOT requires with the engineer, that when they have exceeded the amount that has been originally budgeted, they have to submit for a modification to the reimbursement agreement. And this will also work to carry Pannoni through some of the more of the bidding phase as we move into the construction phase. I wouldn't want anyone to get the wrong impression that this is a matter of Pannoni not being able to live within their budget or Pannoni not doing the job right, so they've had to redo it several times. This is an enormous project. There are 209 properties. There has been a lot of redesign on it in an attempt to accommodate a lot of the residents, but there's also been a lot of redesign as we have dealt with entities like the Southeastern Pennsylvania Transportation Authority, who has not always been easy to deal with, and some of the other property owners, the larger property owners who are involved. This has been reviewed by PennDOT, and PennDOT is in agreement with this.
Okay, thank you for that very thorough explanation. Comments from commissioners on the committee. Commissioner Thompson.
Are we through most of the hurdles on the design process for this particular project? There's four properties, I think, that's remaining, and are there any other curveballs that we know about there?
The project itself, my understanding is the design on the project itself is done, and to the point where PennDOT is comfortable enough with the current design that they're getting ready to take it out for bid if they have not
already begun to authorize the release of the bid specs. Mostly, a lot of what Pannoni has had to change has had to do with some of the SEPTA parcel is one, Stonemore is another, which isn't going to really alter the ultimate design. It's been moving a few things one way or another to deal with utilities and deal with some other issues, but it's not going to alter the ultimate design or really change the timetable on the construction.
Okay.
Commissioner Klein. So the final design costs are the $2.8 million. Is that my understanding by reading the resolution?
Yeah, 2.819.
Went from 2.6 to 2.8, roughly?
That's correct.
And what portion of that, or is the town, is that, is how is that split with PennDOT and those fees? I forget how that was split.
Yeah, and I'm blanking now on what the percentages are, what the township match is, and I'm thinking it's 80-20, but I don't, I don't want to quote that, so if you'll give me till next Thursday, we'll confirm that it's an 80-20, an 80-20 split.
Yeah. So we're looking at increasing, it's about about $150,000. So we'll be on the hook for another $30,000 in fees if it is that 80-20.
If it is that, I'll trust your math on that.
Okay. Yeah, if you can, if we can find out what that split is before the next meeting, that would be helpful.
Will do.
Thank you.
The commissioners, Commissioner Thompson.
Just for clarification, the total project cost on this project is $5.3 million?
I believe that's what's listed in the resolution. That's the information we're getting from PennDOT and Pannoni. So still has to be bid.
So the design fee is 50% of the project?
That's budget? The information we're being given from Pannoni and from PennDOT.
Commissioner Gillespie.
They did have to redesign just even for the, in the section near the cemetery, that all had to be redone again.
Certainly did.
That was a big deal.
Certainly was.
Yeah, so you weren't involved then, but that was a big deal. Yeah. Which is, I think, really good. You know, as I go there and look, it's a great idea, but it did cost a bit of money.
Right. And again, I'm not public relations for Pannoni, but one of the things they've done very well on this project is that they've tried to work with the property owners, and as I mentioned, there were 209 right-of-ways that needed to be acquired. I think when we began the project, it was about 220, 221, somewhere around there. But in working with various property owners, Pannoni has been able to, you know, move something 10 feet one way, and we have eliminated some of the people who weren't in the project. But we're down now to Stonemore and the SEPTA property, and I know a list went out today about listing the four properties that we're still waiting on. And again, one of the other problems Pannoni faced was that SEPTA, it's very hard at times to determine what they own and what they no longer own. So there was some property along the SEPTA rail line that we weren't sure who exactly owned it, so there was a significant amount of digging and then changing depending on where they found certain things. So
I just wish, I mean, I'd love to get a handle on how long it's going to take to get those last four properties. It just seems like forever.
I think we're very close.
Okay.
And yeah, I think that PennDOT is still talking about letting the project by sometime in the early part of this summer. So their timetable is still the early part of the summer of awarding the bid for the project.
Thank you.
Commissioner Klein.
Yeah, we also just reviewed this in the Planning Commission for the TIP, and that's been pushed to 2020 for the TIP, but with the idea that it could be funded earlier if it is let out. So.
Other commissioners. Seeing none, anyone from the public wish to comment on agenda item 3? Hearing none, we're ready to vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? The motion carries. And finally, that brings us to item 4,
consider whether or not to appeal the decision of the Zoning Hearing Board rendered on February 20th, 2018 for application number 1707, the application of Baderwood Residential Partners. Of them. Solicitor Clark, did you want to?
Thank you, Commissioner Sanchez. The Zoning Hearing Board rendered their decision on the second Baderwood zoning decision. As you recall, the previous decision, the Zoning Hearing Board ruled against Baderwood Residential Partners. Baderwood appealed that to the Montgomery County Court of Common Pleas. And while that appeal was pending, they filed a new application with the Zoning Hearing Board. That was heard over the last several months by the Zoning Hearing Board, and they rendered a decision the other day and approved the application of Baderwood Residential Partners. We are recommending that the matter be appealed to the Montgomery County Court of Common Pleas, and then we're going to recommend that both of the we'll request that both of the appeals be consolidated.
And just to go ahead, Manager Manfredi, did you wish to add something to that?
Well, litigation. If I get asked.
Okay.
And Solicitor Clark.
Nope, that was it.
And just before we, and we'll take some questions, obviously, but I would ask that my colleagues support this appeal. This is, keep in mind, this dates back to an agreed upon zoning district that was from litigation where the developer had sued us to and settled that on a validity challenge to the zoning code. And so they had agreed upon it, came in one posture to the zoning board, lost that and appealed it to court. That appeal is still pending. They came back to the zoning court, zoning board in a slightly different posture and prevailed. However, well, I don't want to get into that, the merits of that, but if anyone has any questions, I'm asking. Oh, and to clarify the motion, we would be also a motion which has not been made, but this is to engage Solicitor Clark to take that appeal on behalf of the township against the Zoning Hearing Board, and because this is outside of the retainer amount, it would be to also we authorize the payment of this, the payment of the legal fees to Rudolph Clark. A couple questions down here. Commissioner Gillespie, did you have a question? Commissioner Gillespie.
Thank you. I just, why are we appealing it? I mean, that's, what's our grounds for appealing it if they
defer to the solicitor on that?
There are a couple of different reasons why I think the board should consider appealing this. One is just a pure technical reason that the decision is not really supported by the evidence that was presented at the hearing. As you're aware, the owners of this original property were intimately involved in the writing of the FTD ordinance, and now this is the ordinance that they are appealing from. Much of the issues that they raised at the Zoning Hearing Board in the form of what their hardship was are all essentially self-inflicted hardships. They were involved with the drafting of the FTD ordinance. They then went and did things on the site. And then when they came back and we asked them to live up to what was involved, what is in the ordinance, they said, well, it would be a hardship to do so. But the decision, the main reason I think we should appeal is the decision of the Zoning Hearing Board, it eviscerates the intent of the FTD ordinance, and it ignores completely some of the public safety concerns that were raised during the hearing, specifically issues related to parking, specifically issues related to all of the ingresses and egresses that are on the fairway, to the point where the issue regarding public safety seems to have been largely ignored by the Zoning Hearing Board. And again, going back to the fact that these issues
are mostly self-inflicted. They knew what would happen when they wanted to develop the back portion, but then they took steps selling off all of the parcels. And part of their argument now is, well, we can't do all of these things on the property because we don't own everything. Well, the reason they don't own everything is because they sold everything off over the last couple of years, years, and didn't put in any of their agreements that if they needed to comply with the ordinance, that they would. I did not attend the hearings. Two people from my office did. I think there is a kind of a sense that maybe the zoning hearing board felt badly for these people because they weren't going to be able to build what they wanted to build. But feeling badly is not their job. Following the law and enforcing the zoning code is their job. And we think that for that reason, for all of these reasons, we should appeal this decision.
Okay, so but it wasn't density. I mean, they were okay with that. It's just basically safety and... Okay. It is pretty crowded over there.
Mm-hmm. Saw some other hands. Commissioner Behe.
Being new, I'm only vaguely familiar with this proposal. I'd like to see the application that was submitted just so I can get up to speed, if that can be submitted before the board meeting. Thank you.
Anyone else down there? A couple hands down there. President Luker.
Thank you. Mr. Clark, if I heard you correctly, you said you would like both appeals, the initial appeal and this appeal, to be meshed together?
Ask that they be consolidated so we're not arguing two different things at the same time.
So the first appeal was the applicant.
Correct.
The second appeal would be us to our own zoning hearing board.
And the applicant.
And the applicant.
Right.
And you're requesting that they be consolidated.
We'll ask when we go to the Court of Common Pleas that they consolidate them so we're not fighting two battles at the same time. That will be more cost effective for the township, that will only be dealing with one case and not two different cases.
And the solicitor for the zoning hearing board is aware of this appeal on our part?
He's aware of the first one. I don't know if he's aware that we are contemplating appealing the second one.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Spiegelman. Just to put things in perspective, Commissioner Sanchez, and Solicitor Clark and Manager Manfredi can correct me if I'm wrong, it's certainly not a total aberration for a municipality to appeal a decision of its own zoning hearing board. I mean, that's the whole reason zoning hearing boards are a separate quasi-judicial body and have their own solicitor, right? I mean, this isn't some completely strange occurrence if we proceed with this.
It certainly is not a completely strange occurrence. While I would say, I wouldn't venture to say that it happens, you know, every day, it happens frequently. They are an independent body.
Exactly. Thank you.
Just to that point, let me also, because I failed to mention it, this board voted twice to oppose the applicant's application at both zoning board hearings unanimously. Commissioner Shriver.
I think you said this, but I want to just check. The reason that the second time the zoning hearing board agreed with the applicant is not based on changes in the two.
No, the second application is a different application. The applicant changed a little bit of what they had originally. You can't bring the same one back while one is pending.
But are those changes what was responsible for them changing their votes?
I don't know. They have not.
I mean, were they significant enough? Let me ask it that way to make them think this is what we originally.
Possibly. They've not issued an opinion yet. They've not issued their findings of fact and conclusions of law yet. They'll do that. They have a certain time after the decision is rendered to issue their findings of fact and conclusions of law. There is some confusion right now in the courts as to when you have to file your appeal. Some believe that you can wait until after the findings of fact and conclusions of law, even if that occurs 30 days after the decision is made. In an abundance of caution, it seems to be the common a practice now that everyone is filing their appeal within 30 days of the original decision being rendered, just to make sure you don't run into any problems with somebody saying, well, it's not timely. But ultimately, they do have to issue a findings of fact and conclusions of law. And then if it's appealed to the Court of Common Pleas, that those findings of fact and the entire record gets transmitted up to the Court of Common Pleas.
So at that time, if we do agree to this, after reading the reason, we could take the appeal off if we wanted to at that point. But in order to do it in a timely fashion, we have to do this now. Is that correct?
That's correct. Anything is possible. I cannot imagine that anything that will be written will make us change our opinion that this decision was not supported by the law.
Okay. I understand that. I just want to make sure.
Commissioner Gillespie.
And we will have additional legal fees. Is that the question we're
We will. There are always various factors that come into play. We estimate that this will probably take us anywhere in a range of about 30 to 40 hours to take it through to its conclusion. So we're talking probably somewhere in the range of $5,000 to $7,000.
Commissioner Rothman.
Solicitor Clark, just following up on that, that's through the conclusion, the full?
That's what we estimate. That's okay. Taking us all the way to the conclusion in the Montgomery County Court of Common Pleas.
Okay, thank you.
And that And that money comes from
unbalance.
Are you timing me?
No, I was getting an email. I believe it was an email from somebody saying let Carol speak.
I believe the money comes from the legal fees until that's exhausted, and then it would be beyond that in the natural course fund balance. Correct me if I'm wrong on that, Manager Manfredi. Or
any cost from the moment you do this, I didn't hear a cap on it, but what you had said would be is anything outside of the retainer, every case by case, the litigation presents a number and you approve that. If it hits, it goes above that number, you'd have to come back and reapprove it.
Their books and leave, is that?
Pardon me?
I said then they pick up their books and just leave the hearing. Just a joke.
Commissioner Klein.
So I had gone to, I think, two out of the three of the hearings, and I would agree with Commissioner Sanchez and support the appeal of the Zoning Hearing Board. Having been involved in the drafting of the FTD ordinance and that whole process of the validity challenge and working with Brandolini at that time, I'm shocked that some of the variances were granted on this project, because some of the variances that were granted were vital in the drafting of the FTD ordinance, and some of the main reasons why we put some of those things in there was because of the type of development that could be put into that location. So I agree with trying to appeal this, because I think the decision is just detrimental to the township, period.
Thank you, Commissioner Klein. Other commissioners? Commissioner Hecker.
Thank you, Commissioner Sanchez. So while I'm not an expert in this particular subject matter, what I can say is that Commissioner Sanchez, you've been a strong advocate of smart development in the township during our time on the board together. And you've had to walk a tightrope with a number of complicated projects, more than most of us have seen in a short period of time. The Patients First facility, Penn State Abington, the YMCA, and this. And you've asked your colleagues for support in this regard, and I think we have an obligation to defer to your time and energy and expertise. So I'm enthusiastically in support of your recommendation.
I appreciate that. Thank you, Commissioner Hecker. Other commissioners, members of the audience, on this fourth agenda item.
Laura Lehman, 1431 Bryant Lane. Mr. Sanchez, would you let Mr. Clark perhaps answer, was the township allowed to have a witness for the township that was party to the proceedings at the Zoning Hearing Board? And did we have that? Could you ask Mr. Clark if he would answer?
I can answer that. Having observed them during the first round of hearings, the zoning officer, Mr. Penicow, was called as a witness.
Mr. Pennekow was called as a witness?
Correct.
Okay. Was no one else needed? Because obviously it seems that there was something missing. So could Mr. Clark have?
No, I believe the second time. See, this is where it breaks down, because you get answer one question, it's like feeding a stray animal.
I'm trying to understand the issues in my township.
It's complicated. You should have come to all the zoning hearing board meetings. So there were many. I'm surprised you weren't there. But anyway, it was an argument of the law the second time around, more so. So no, they didn't leave any stone unturned in their appeal.
Okay.
They did a great job.
All right. When you come and clean my bathroom, I'll come to all your zoning meetings, okay? So the second question I have is, or comment that I have, is to be careful what we wish for, because I think, in general, the residents do want to see the compliance. This particular developer has created something that is, you know, can't be let go. So I think many of us would like to see that appeal and have that done. But in the be careful what you wish for, the measures that have to be done on the bottom lot before he is allowed to build on the top lot are measures in some cases where we are building right up to the sidewalk. And I would like to point out that you have had a great deal of feedback from the YMCA and other properties that this is not what residents want. So when it comes to doing that, the residents do not want skyscrapers up to the sidewalk all the way up the fairway. And this is one of my concerns, is because I know some of that incentive that was given for them to be able to build in the back was to do things that residents don't want in the front. Mm-hmm. It was driven by commissioners, and although they heard plenty of testimony, they did not listen to it. Okay? So I will leave it there. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. We're ready to vote. So the motion has been moved and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? No. The motion carries. All right, that concludes the formal business of the Administrative Code and Land Use Committee for this evening. We will now take public comment on general matters of Administrative Code and Land Use.
Laura Lehman, 1431 Bryant Lane. So one of the things that I would like to ask is, I am grateful that we did not do the waiver thing tonight for the school. I don't believe that anybody should be doing any waivers out of our budget unless they know exactly what the amount is and whether we can afford it, where it's coming from, and so on. And I also agree with nobody should get a waiver that somebody else doesn't get. It should be equal. Same thing with the VFW and everything else. But what we didn't do is we didn't have another motion that said, please, no waivers, period. So I don't want to see the school. I don't want to see an exception for a political subdivision. But I would like to hear somebody say, no waivers. Everyone gets treated equally. And if you want to help the VFW, you don't take it out of taxpayer pockets. You let the VFW people use their wonderful lists, and you hold a fundraiser so that you can pay for their fees. That's how it should work, so the willing people are doing that. Okay, and also, we already covered that one. So the other thing that I want to say is the BETYMCA. Again, that should never have been considered, and I would like to see a motion from somebody that we don't take this to any formal meeting. Anybody who comes in doesn't go to any formal meeting until first they vet with the residents. And again, for the residents, Mr. Sanchez, your particular job here at code enforcement needs documents. You need one page and an email list when something new is added to that page. Please do that for the residents. They need your help.
Thank you for your comments. With that, I'll make a motion. We adjourn.
So moved.
We're adjourned.
Make everything in my arm's reach now. Good evening, everyone. We're calling the Public Safety Committee to order this evening, February 28th, 2018. Can I have a call to order, please?
Commissioner Schreiber?
Here.
DuPlessida?
Here.
Rothman?
Here.
Thompson?
Here.
Bacon?
Here.
And consideration of the minutes, motion to approve the minutes of the January 31st, 2018 Public Safety Committee meeting, and I so move.
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded. Any changes, corrections from anybody? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And the minutes have been approved. We have a report tonight from our Chief Malloy.
Yep. Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the board. I just have a few things that I want to brief the board on. One, I know Commissioner Rothman and others, I've notified the manager on an arrest that took place back on February 3rd. It was a rainy Saturday night, and Detective Lieutenant Steve Fink, a number of our officers were in Lower Merion on a very complex investigation, plainclothes investigation that involved a multi-jurisdictional crime. Burglaries, 20 burglaries in Abington will be cleared, and they started in October of 2017 and ended sometime around the first of the year. This detective, Lieutenant Fink, and a number of our patrol officers were reassigned for several weeks, very patiently followed this suspects, and this is going to make news shortly. It's now in the hands of the DA's office, where they'll be able to reveal more information soon. But I will tell you that thousands of articles were recovered, and we can identify many of them to 20 burglaries in Abington Township. And shortly you'll receive information on how you can go on our website, see photographs of those articles, and I have no doubt they're going to clear many more burglaries. In light of the school shooting in Broward County, Florida, Dr. Sickle invited us to the school board meeting just last night, and I know that Commissioners Klein and Spiegelman were there. I wasn't sure if I was at a school board meeting or a township meeting, but anyway, it was an opportunity for us to highlight some of the great work that's being done by our school resource officers, Sean Gargan and Andy Gibbs, our emergency management coordinator, Tom McEnany, Steve Hocklin, who's a retired lieutenant, is the director of school safety at the school district. But it was really nice that Dr. Sickle and Mr. McGarry invited us there to highlight the collaboration that has been going on for decades now, I would say. Not as a reaction to the school violence, but there have been so many things in place because of the cooperation and leadership of my predecessors, Bill Kelly and John Livingood, and sort of the culture that we had of cooperation with the school district. So I just wanted you to be aware of that. That it was a great evening, and it was nice to see members of the school board to compliment the great relationship that the Abington Police Department School District have, especially when it comes to school safety and all the protocols. And we're coming up to the springtime. I wanted to warn residents about transient criminals. These are those criminals that will prey on the vulnerable, usually elderly, widows and widowers, and they would do the driveway scams. They also would do the diversionary burglaries where they would pose as utility workers, and they had an ability to sometimes get into the homes. And when they victimize these older folks, our senior citizens, not only are the senior citizens lose the monetary value of what's taken, but they're oftentimes afraid to report this to their loved ones for fear that they would lose their independence. So they're basically victimized twice. I just want the public to be aware of this, because if you have neighbors who are older, who live alone, just please do your best to keep an eye out for them. Our department in the springtime, our officers are aware of some of these actors that are out there, but I think it's a good time to warn the citizens about those types of crimes. And two final things, I just wanted to make everyone aware of the Real Diamond concert, which is coming up on March 10th at the Keswick Theater at 7:30 p.m. You can get the tickets through community policing. Sergeant Gillespie would be the contact. I believe they're only $25 if you buy them in-house. You won't have the fees that Keswick Theater charges. But that does, it's one of our biggest fundraisers in the spring and supports all of the activities for our police athletic program. So I'm asking the board and the public to support that. And one other thing that we have, this is being run by Melissa Gargan and Citizens and Police Together. It's our designer bag bingo. That'll be on Friday night, the 9th, at the North Penn VFW. Doors open at 6. I think it's $30, and that includes beer, wine, snacks. And if you're into designer bags, I'm told there's some great selection of designer bags. So that's my report.
You can make a whole weekend of it.
Yeah.
Both of the two events. Very good. Thank you. Any questions?
Commissioner Schreiber, I just want to say I have been hearing feedback all day. The excellent work that Chief Malloy and the rest of the command staff and our old friend Steve Hawkwin did at the presentation last night. It really was outstanding, so thank you very much. A lot of good feedback. A lot of buzz on Facebook. You know, it's important.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Commissioner Rutherford.
Chief Malloy, thank you very much for keeping me posted on, I know a lot of those burglaries took place in my ward, so thank you. We'll get the word out in accordance with the plan that the police department comes up with as to the release of information. Since I already have you working on a little blurb I can send out on that, if we could get something I think that all of the commissioners can share as to the scams that you just referenced.
Yes.
That might have some particulars and answer some of the questions that you would anticipate we get back. That would be probably something good that we can share with the community as well. So I would recommend that because it does sound really awful for the victims, particularly with the second aspect, what you said, losing their independence. Is something that I'm sure is a major focus and concern. So thank you.
Yep, we'll get that out.
If you want to include, I don't know if you want to put it in the same thing, because I know this is timely with the spring, but some of the phone scams, I know we've put them out before, but you know, where people, because it's the tax time and people are getting the calls from the IRS and that kind of thing, which they wouldn't, those are scams.
Yes.
So if you could,
Sergeant Gillespie, I'll ask him. He does have something related to that he could put out.
Thank you. Any other commissioner comments? Thank you. All right, thank you.
Thanks.
And I want to announce that we have Rich Garrett from Second Alarmers waving in the audience there, and he'll be speaking to us at an upcoming meeting. And I also want to announce, we had our fire board meeting tonight. Both Dave Schramm and John Rohr are here, and they will in the future be doing a presentation, I believe, with some statistics. We have very good statistics to report from the fire companies. So thank you, gentlemen, too. That's a teaser. That's right. So stay tuned. That's right. And we have one agenda item this evening on our committee. PS1 is to consider authorizing township officials to accept a grant from the North Central Highway Safety Network, Inc. in the amount of $15,000 with the township's matching portion of $1,000. The township match will cover the Social Security costs of the officers working the grant, as this expense is not covered by the grant. At the conclusion of the grant, the Social Security expense will be transferred to 01-04-044-5110, and I so move.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion from commissioners? Questions? Staff or audience? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion carries. And that concludes our formal agenda this evening. I'll call for public comment on matters related to public safety.
Laura Lehman, 1431 Bryant Lane. In reference to the BET YMCA proposal and others coming out, I have been trying to get the information on something so simple. It is whether or not we wrote the letter to labor and industry to ask to have the firewalls ordinance continued that we've had for 70 years, that Fire Marshal Clark had testified to the fact that it would save lives, it would save his firefighters, and at that meeting that we had on 313, I guess it was, we were talking about having to send that to them, and Mr. Rohrer, I think, said that there was some sense that they would agree if we just sent that in. So where does that stand? Have we sent that letter?
Do you have any other questions? And then you can
sit
down when you're done.
I do, but but they're based on that.
Okay.
Well, I would like to know if we've sent that letter, and then I have.
We would like a list of your questions, and then you can have a seat, and I'll see.
Is there some reason for doing that? Because you know that leads to less understanding and less ability for residents to be able to communicate to their commissioners. So I'm talking now. Okay. So it leads to less.
No, I was talking.
Yeah, but I was talking.
You have 3 minutes. You know the rules. You have been here many, many, many times.
I have.
So the
I
rules
have.
Are
the
you
rules
come up
are
for
not
3 minutes,
good.
And you can. And you were here when we passed the rules. Those rules include you can include any of your questions that you want, and then you have a seat. At that point, the person presiding over the meeting can decide if that is going to have answers or if we will wait till after the meeting's over.
I understand that.
But because I was talking, you have 2 minutes left. I will give you an extra minute. You can proceed.
Okay. So I am endlessly going to try and explain to you that as long as you have rules that are obtuse and do not work for the residents in terms of comprehension and in terms of being able to relate back and forth to their commissioners to be able to resolve important issues like public safety and this firewalls issue is one, I will continue to try to get that across to you, that it does not behoove me to sit down and then ask a bunch of questions when you answer a couple if you want to, but my next question is based on what that first answer was. And I've explained that to you many times. And there is no cooperation. And so many of the bad things that have happened in this township, and I know a lot of them that have happened simply because of this attitude that you're displaying now, what Commissioner Sanchez displayed a few minutes ago, and what has been repeatedly displayed from that side of the dais. It needs to change. There are many communities where free conversation is allowed back and forth for comprehension, and then if they can't decide at that point what to do, they talk about it later. That doesn't happen here. Oh, it might happen for a few people. But it doesn't happen for somebody who's bringing the hard issues to you and not going away when you go, well, we don't want to deal with them, okay? And I'm not going away. These are important things. People's lives have been ruined and people have been left in danger. And I'm standing up here to try and change that.
Your time is up. You did ask one question, and I don't know if anybody has an answer for that or if you would, management, for no question, no answer at this time. Thank you for your comments.
You don't even know if a letter was sent? Nobody
Thank you for
knows,
your
or they're just
this
refusing
is not a
to answer.
And forth. Thank you for your
they're
comments.
They're just refusing to answer. Lovely.
Are there any other comments from the audience? Hearing none, the meeting is adjourned.
So moved.
The presentation. I didn't do the presentation. All right, are we ready? You know what? I declare that we're ready. All right, it is my pleasure to call to order the February 28th, 2018 Township of Abington Public Affairs Committee meeting. And let us start with the roll call.
Commissioner Spiegelman?
Here.
Goodman?
Here.
Barber?
Here.
Here.
Here. Off to a good start. Approval of the minutes. This is a motion to approve the minutes of the January 31st, 2018 Public Affairs Committee meeting, and I so move.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any questions or corrections? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Minutes are approved. I am so happy to welcome my colleagues and friends from the Vacant Property Review Board for a presentation of all of the fine things we've been doing. Our chairman, Bob Greaves, is here. So, Bob, come and introduce yourself and take it away.
Take it away. My name is Bob Greaves. I'm currently the chair of the Vacant Property Review Board. I'm a long-term resident of Abington and happy to chair as the Vacant Property Review Board at this point. The goal tonight is to just give you a brief update of what the the committee has been doing. It's actually been 2 years. I think my first official interview after retirement was actually with this group, and I've been at it ever since. It's been a very enjoyable experience, and appreciate working in the township. Just by way of quick background, the two ordinances were passed in July of 2015, and essentially they give the township the authority to deal with vacant commercial properties. The first meeting of the Property Review Board was held in March of 2016, and Commissioner Spiegelman was nice enough to kick things off and take on the lead as the chair for the first year. This lists the current team, which is basically contemplated by the ordinance. There are three residents on the team and a number of other folks from different commissions and boards on the township. So as a new board, we set out some goals to get started. And I think in retrospect, we did a pretty good job of doing that, although I think in retrospect, it was probably turned out to be a bigger chunk of work than anybody actually expected. I think with any new enterprise, the team has learned as we've progressed, and I think the process has in fact become more refined as we've gotten experience in dealing with these kinds of sites. What I'd like to do next is just quickly touch on some of the activities that we've taken to meet the goals that I just outlined. The one thing I think that's really good is that we now have an active list of sites that's regularly updated. These sites are typically inspected by enforcement folks and then are followed up by discussion with the board for follow-up action. We flowcharted the process, which was quite challenging. And I think what we've also tried to do is to take a look at other townships to see how they deal with these types of properties. Typically, code enforcement follows through the board recommendations, including issuance of notice letters if action is required by the owner. And I think we've also engaged with some outreach, which I'll touch on in a few minutes here. I would say, in general, the notice letters have been helpful in terms of motivating owners to address violations. What we've been able to do is to give specific information on what issues need to be addressed. And we've also told folks that they are potentially under review as a blighted property, which I think has also helped to generate some forward action. Just a couple of examples of what we've been able to do so far. I think this is the former Midas property before picture. It was probably about a year ago. And if you drive down Old York Road now, you'll see a property that looks significantly different. I think the one remaining challenge is to get somebody in the building, but I'll talk about that in a second as well. But I think, again, as a result of a notice letter, several meetings with code enforcement staff, we've I think seen significant progress, and the property is up for lease or rent at this point. Just another example is Tyson Avenue, a former beer distributor, and again, after a good bit of back and forth, again, we've seen some pretty good progress. So this is what we've been trying to do with the list of facilities that we've had. I think for the upcoming year, what we'd like to do is to continue to build on the work that we've started. I think we've got, I think, about 20 properties on the list at this point. But I think the one thing that we'd like to also do this year is to maybe place more emphasis on reaching out to other organizations to see if we can get these properties across the finish line. An example of that is actually another 8 o'clock meeting tomorrow morning, meeting with the Economic Development Committee. Again, just to see if we can explore options with other groups within the township to see if we can maybe, again, get these properties, you know, to where we want to see them. That's it. I wanted to, again, thank Commissioner for giving me the opportunity to talk about what we're doing, and if there are any questions, I'd be happy to entertain them.
That was incredibly efficient, Bob. You covered everything.
I know it's late.
any questions from commissioners to Chairman Greaves? Commissioner Gillespie.
It's nice to see the properties improved, and Messina's is in my ward. And they did pay, it's their responsibility to fix it up like that, correct?
Yes.
And that was the same thing with the Midas building, correct? They fixed it up?
With
whoever owned it.
I'm sorry.
Midas?
Yes, yes.
Same thing, they fixed it up. Looks good. Okay, thank you.
Commissioner DiPlacido.
So just a question for the group. So the fines that are being levied now for these vacant properties, how are we capturing that information? Because there's a few properties in my particular ward and a few others around that. I just wanted to see if they're actually paying them and things like that. Or is that on your end? Do you keep a tally of those?
I was going to say code enforcement would probably be the best source for that.
Yeah, okay. our representative from code enforcement, our representative on the committee is Sean Littlefield, and he keeps the up-to-date records on all that because he's the one who sends out the letters, and that's one of the things we review at the beginning of every meeting is sort of the status updates and if anyone applies for a waiver, et cetera.
Okay.
Thanks. Okay. President Luker.
Yes, I think this is excellent work on your part, and also Commissioner Spiegelman. My question kind of follows up on Commissioner DiPlacido. Have any of these had to be moved to the District Justice for citations?
I believe there's one that's going to hearing right now.
Yeah.
Okay. But I think this is good stuff. Good.
Yeah, I think we've been trying to be consistent and essentially apply, you know, the requirements that are out there in terms of notification and whatnot. So I think following through for people that don't.
And the other question I have is, do you try to encourage the property owners to expedite the sale of these properties or to get tenants for them?
I think that's the hardest part of this, to be honest with you. I think what we've been trying to do is to work with residents, or with the owners rather, to get the properties to where they should be. I think the next step of this is what I just mentioned is, you know, how can we then help folks to get them? I'd like to see this to be more than just sort of a hammer committee where we're just sort of pounding on people and making them, you know, we need to make sure they pay fines and follow the requirements. But I think it would be great if you could also maybe try to offer a little bit more. And I think that's what we're trying to explore right now. What kinds of things would they be? And I think that's sort of what we'd like to work on this year. I think the discussion with EDC is a good example of, you know, we'll see where that goes. I mean, we're just sort of reaching out and exploring at this point.
Well, I think you and the committee are doing an excellent job.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, President Luker. Just also to expand on Bob's answer, it is actually one of the, if a property owner requests a fee waiver, one of the burden of proof is on them to show that they have actually been actively and reasonably marketing the property. So, you know, they have to submit, you know, whether it's an MLS listing or.
So you say they do have to show proof of actively marketing
if
the property.
If they're requesting a waiver, they have to show, one of the things they have to show is proof that, first of all, they have to take care of the code issues.
Right.
But they also have to show proof that they are marketing the property. Okay. And there's easy ways to do that, but you know, a picture of a little, you know, 8.5 by 11 handwritten sign on the door saying for lease doesn't exactly cut it.
Okay. Right. Thank you,
Commissioner DiPlacido, then Commissioner Schreiber.
So what's the average time? Say let's use a retail business for instance. What's the average time one spends on the vacant property review board or gets continually reviewed?
In terms of the facility itself?
Yeah.
You know, it sort of depends on how cooperative they are and how fast it goes. I mean, some of these take a while. Some people, you know, you have a discussion and they'll go do the stuff. And, you know, at that point, it's not really a blighted property anymore. Other folks take a little bit longer. I think it just depends. I mean, the Midas property took quite a while, as an example.
It was quite a while.
Months, right? Months.
A few months?
Yeah, more than
a year?
Yeah, year,
two?
Year to 1 to 2 years, maybe.
Okay.
And there are some other properties that I think both of you know well that are a little more complicated to deal with. But I think, you know, on the flip side, we have quite a few success stories. I mean, there are a number of properties now that are completely occupied.
Right. I was going to say, there are, if you look at the list, there are ones that are dropping to the bottom that are, you know, not of interest anymore because they have been, you know, they are being reused.
Okay. Thanks.
Commissioner Schreiber.
I was just going to say that one of the, what you had just said is if they're trying to get a waiver,
then they have to prove that they're actively marketing it. The problem is if they don't apply for a waiver and just continually get fees, so the fees go up, and most people right. wouldn't want to pay them. But if they do want to pay them, there's nothing to show that they're really actively marketing in a way that shows the market value to be comparable to other things in that area.
Right. Well, yeah, I mean, and that is a situation. Like, if there's a claim, again, I certainly know what property you're talking about. If there's a claim.
There's more than one property like that.
That is true. If there's a claim that it's being actively marketed, but it's at such an out of market range price, then we take that into consideration because that's not, I mean, you know, if a property that would if the normal range of a property is, I'm just going to make up figures, $25 a square foot, and they have it for lease at $125 a square foot, obviously they have no intention of ever really finding anyone to lease that, and that's something we take into consideration.
One more.
All right. That's Bob. I know we want to hear from you.
So. So the property stays on. Does the board make suggestion or volunteer any type of advice on how to either sell the property or get out of the fine structure? Is that part of its
duties? I think
duties?
From the board perspective, I mean, the board is really there looking to determine whether or not the property is vacant and blighted. So once it's sort of rehabilitated, it sort of comes off, the list per se. I mean, it's not a candidate as a blighted property at that point. I think what we've been trying to do is to see, what could we do at that point? For example, could we hand that off to another entity in the township? Would the Economic Development Committee perhaps be interested in taking on a property at that point that then they could give advice on how to better market the property or whatnot?
And that's discussed in the meetings?
Yes.
As well? Okay.
Right. And that's where we're trying to go right now, because I think we've made decent progress in terms of getting folks sort of compliant, and some of these have gotten fixed up. But the question then becomes, can the township be more maybe proactive in terms of trying to help folks, get it to get it to the finish line and get it redeveloped? I mean, to me, that's the goal, is to get it back into active use.
Mm-hmm.
So what is it that we can do at that point? And I think that's where we are at this point. I think we've sort of gone through a process, set it up, learned a bunch of stuff, try to make sure people comply with the requirements. Now that we have some people that are there, what can we then do to, try to help these guys get to the finish line, to the extent that they're interested?
Great. Thanks.
Yeah. Bob, thank you very much.
Bob.
See you in 11 hours.
Yes.
All right, moving on to our formal agenda. We are going to start with unfinished business. This is item PA2. It's a motion to consider accepting the apparent low bid of $45,752.50 from Think Green to complete the Ardsley Wildlife Sanctuary Trail Phase 1 construction project, and I so move.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Manager Manfredi, who is going to...
Mr. Oles is coming to the podium.
Oh, hello, Mr. Oles. I'm sorry. You were behind the column. You were completely camouflaged from me. Hello, Director Oles.
So, we rebid this from the last time when all the bids were over what we had. We adjusted the scope of the project a little bit, doing some stuff in-house to lessen it. And we rebid it to all this. We had about 8 bidders. And the apparent low bidder, responsible low bidder, was Think Green, who had bid it the first time. So we were very happy with what they could provide and do for the project. So, and it does come in under what we had budgeted for.
Yeah, the certainly significant movement in the right direction. Any questions from members of the committee? From commissioners in general? Commissioner Klein, any more budget numbers you want to know about? Good. From our audience. Thank you, Director Olson.
Laura Raven, 1431 Bryant Lane, and as you've heard me say many times, we have an entire forest dying in the Boy Scout Preserve, and a little bit of money came in this year, finally, to do something with that. It won't do much because of the amount of money, and it would be my recommendation that you don't spend money until all of your parks are stabilized, beautifying one park while one park is dying. Major trees are dying in that park, covered with vines, and they need attention. And they are treasures, they are gems in this township. It frightens me to think that perhaps that's going to be a Todd and we're looking for commercial development there. I can't even imagine any other reason for letting the beautiful trees die. But here you have $45,000 that you found. I'm not sure why that money wouldn't go into the park that so desperately needs it. Thank you.
Thank you. All right. I think we're ready to vote. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. PA 2 passes. And our one item of new business is PA 1. This is a motion to consider accepting a tree vitalized community forestry management grant in the amount of $8,130, and I so move.
Second.
These are, I know folks who have been on the board are probably pretty familiar with these by now, but Mr. Manfredi's, Mr. Rolls, sorry. Any comment, especially for the new folks who...
This was one that was on for a while. We were waiting for Tree Vitalized to actually approve. They got held up. Mm-hmm. And if you look back through the things, this was on the agenda for a while. And the only reason it got held up was from Tree Vitalized itself had a log jam in their side. So we finally got it. We had the match already put in the budget for it. And we're going to use it for hopefully strengthening or bolstering the tree ordinance and some other things through the Shade Tree Commission.
Thank you very much. Any questions from members of the board? Members of the committee, excuse me. Commissioners in general. Audience.
Laura Lehman, same address. Opposed until you start finding grants for what we need instead of we're going to use it for something maybe. Thank you.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
PA 1 passes. That concludes our formal agenda. We'll entertain public comment in the general and exotic wide purview of public affairs. It is exotic and wide purview.
Laura Lane.
Always name and address and 3 minutes.
1431 Bryant Lane. And so, Commissioner, you are the chair of the particular committee that handles public speaking rights. What you've seen tonight is an example of public speaking that is not working. There's not communication from residents to the commissioners at this podium and to that dais. And that should be changed. In addition, you changed the presentation to people that we worked for years to get. A dozen years ago, we started when they said all in favor, aye, on the agenda. And people who came for an issue, it was over before they even knew where they were allowed to speak, and they weren't given an opportunity later. So we worked to have you say, commissioners, staff, and audience. And we worked very hard to get that. And then we had speaking at both meetings. And then that was taken away at the Board of Commissioner meeting. And now what's been taken away is at the last meeting, I just saw somebody say we have something called consent items. This wasn't done in the public. There were no public hearings. We just decided that you were going to name these things consent items and decide that somebody, perhaps the manager, perhaps you guys, all decided they didn't need any more explanation or discussion. So we already lost our discussion on them, okay? But now they didn't need any explanation either, so we went, items A through K, all in favor, aye. Nobody even got read what the items were that were being passed. This is absolutely not acceptable. This is back to worse than we were when we started. And in addition, the ability to have questions answered in this forum has been left up to the discretion of the chair. And when you have somebody who's saying, I need to know that answer before I ask my next question, and somebody just sits there and goes, no, not doing it, That person shouldn't be in a public position. That person shouldn't be in charge of people's lives, somebody who does that. So I want you to please consider proposing some speaking rules that expand our rights rather than reduce them, because the entire time that you have been chair of this committee, they have been reduced. And I would like to see them expanded, and I would like you to take some responsibility for that. The other thing is you have some...
I got about 15 seconds left, just so you know.
Right, you have some citizens coming up at the next meeting that are apparently going to get citations when they should be making apologies. And one of them, for instance, is really responsible for the vacant properties that we saw when I requisitioned those documents.
Your time has expired, so please
literally,
wrap it up.
Let me finish my sentence, please.
No, I said please wrap it up in the next 10 seconds.
Okay, so most of those things had only a sheet that they quickly printed out from Montgomery County and stuck in a file and called it a file. And when I called Mrs. Midas, she had not even been asked to fix her property up. So it was our zoning and code people who were not doing their jobs that caused the blight.
Your time has expired. Thank you. Name and address, please.
Philomena Delancey, 812 Monroe Avenue. I have lived on Monroe Avenue. I'm literally four houses from Ardsley Wildlife Sanctuary. I'm sure Commissioner Stapone knows we used to call it floaties. I moved two houses up from my mom when I got married. I grew up in those woods. I have loved those woods my entire life. They built the quarry, and I was like, ah. But my concern is, last summer, my 13-year-old was walking through with his friends, going to that little dirt bike ramp they have at the other entrance at the sanctuary. And, you know, you see trash there. Maybe you'll see, like, little baggies here and there. But last summer, he found 12 to 13 needles. I know Commissioner Stapone contacted the police department. They contacted me, and they sent somebody out. I'm assuming, because I went the next day, they were removed. But just please take into consideration, I love the sanctuary. I'm always going to call it floaties. It's never going to be different. I love it. I do. I love it. I love being able to bring my kids in there, because I grew up in there. We need to figure out how to keep, what the upkeep is. Because, you know, there, 800 block of Monroe Avenue, the traffic is insane with people and dogs, and I love it. But in the same aspect, there's a lot of young children that go in there and trash it and come out and don't care. I mean, I see it. I see groups of kids walking down my street, going in there, coming out. I'll go right back in there, and there's trash everywhere. I mean, I'm picking it up myself a lot of the times just because I love it so much, and I've been there my whole life, and I respect it. But just if you could just take into consideration the cleanliness of it. Like, I don't care if we have to start cleaning groups and stuff like that. I have enough on my plate. I don't want to start it myself. But if we could just try to figure out how needles. I mean, that was huge. That was big. So thank you for all you do.
Thank you very much, Ms. Delancey. I know that, I'm sure Commissioner Zappone will be in touch. I saw Director Oles and Chief Molloy both taking notes, so I think it's safe to say they'll be follow up on that. Thank you very much. All right. With no other questions or comments, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Adjourned.